we'll see how it goes. And they saw the work and they saw the commitment that I had to writing scripts, and they were impressed. And soon, it was then that it sort of just went boom for me. And people really responded well to my characters. They responded well to me, you know, having a go at authority. And it just was, it was
just a natural.
Yeah, and it was like everything that I'd been doing all my life, now that was a rehearsal and now here we are.
Okay. So when you were on Countdown, how long were you on Countdown
for? I was just a dancer there for like just 8 months or something. Yeah.
You weren't just a dancer. You were dancing, you were there, you were performing.
Yeah.
And doing, you know, a paid position that you were enjoying.
Yes, it was great. I mean, it was just funny. They put the call out for dancers and club dancers. You know, we all danced in clubs, so we turned up. And then it became a thing, the Countdown dancers. We were just sort of meant to be the background, and then suddenly we were the Countdown dancers. And
I remember watching Countdown.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is like near the end of the show, before it sort of got axed. But, yeah.
Great. Now, and then you progressed from there to where?
Well, that was when Molly spotted me and asked me to open the show.
Right.
And then the executive producer of Countdown rang my house. I don't know how he got my number. Rang me and said, we'd like to audition you for a new show. Would you like to come in? And I did. And I thought it was an audition for dancing. I didn't think for a moment that it was. And I turned up and it was, I thought it would just be one audition. It was like 5 auditions and then the pilot and, you know, and then they weren't sure when they were going to go with me. They took the 2 girls. It was Alex Papps and Andrew Dado hosting, and yeah, and then eventually they were going to get rid of me because I wanted to be serious youth affairs.
Oh goodness.
And I was like, no, I can't do it, you know, because every time I went out to do a serious story, I just turned it into something
funny.
I couldn't help it. And so they just, you know, basically let go and let me go. And that was when things changed.
And what program was that?
That was The Factory.
Right.
Yeah.
And how long did that run for?
That ran from 88 to 89, the end of 89.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So you had a lot of fun. Can you recall any of the episodes that are special to you? Things that you really loved?
Well, I mean, I was churning out 20 minutes of TV a week, written and also ad-libbed. And so then I was churning out all this material, so it's more the material that I remember, and people come up to me and they remember stuff, and this was a long time ago, and they will say, remember that Christmas thing that you did and the Christmas tree was burning behind you? And I was like, no, but it sounds hilarious.
So what can you remember, you know?
I think some of the big ones were when I did Bimbo Bitch from Hell, looking for Sylvester Sloan was in town. Looking for, he was doing publicity for Rambo.
Right.
So I made up that I was Bimbo, his Siamese twin sister separated at birth, and I was now looking to catch up with him. And so that.
You didn't happen to catch up with him, did you?
No, I just missed him, but I commando crawled right through the press conference.
Did you?
Yeah. And the press were all, you know, like, what is going on? And I'm throwing ropes, and by the time I got there, he was gone.
He was gone. Oh, what a shame.
But yeah, so there was Bimbo Bitch from Hell. There was another really well-known sketch where I used to do Nana Muscuri.
Oh, okay.
And yes. That became so popular. You know, I'd do this Nana Muscuri impersonation and I'd sing her songs and all this kind of stuff. And it just became like really cult. And then that year, there was a float at Gay Mardi Gras with Nana Muscuri's.
Really?
Yeah, and I was like, yes,
she's back.
I've reopened her career to a new audience.
Giving her a different perspective in
life.
Yeah, showing another side of her.
Yeah, so there was, Nana was very popular, and then these things that I did, I had a character called Carlos, and I dressed as a man, and I really have to say, I did look like a man.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, good costuming and good makeup.
Yep. And people would come up to me in shops when I was in costume and be like, can I help you, sir?
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was just too weird. And it was weird because I'd look in the mirror when my makeup was done and I'd think, where have I gone? I just couldn't see myself.
But that's great. That's amazing to be able to transform from a person. And I often wonder when you look at actors and there's their real life and then they're portraying this character and they really have to get into it, and really professional actors have to portray someone in some form of life, and most of the time they do a brilliant job.
Yeah, most of the time they do.
Yeah, most of the time.
But it's quite a weird experience to look at your face and not see yourself anymore. That was weird. But anyway, he was very popular. And I also used to do these things called walk-ins, or if you know, Maggie Thatcher came to visit and she decided to do a Bourke Street Mall walk, which just turned into a riot. And I was there in the middle of it, covering it, you know, like right up close. And then another time the Queen came and I covered her tour in a really rebellious way.
So what sort of things were you doing?
Well, I was just, my mission on the Queen tour was actually to get the Queen to speak into my microphone. And she picked me out in the crowd and just did not. She glared at me in a way that was like, my producer even turned to me and went,
don't even come near me.
And then they were going to pull me off the tour because the Queen wasn't happy. And because I was dressed, you know, in hat and gloves and everything. And then
you were taking her off.
Yes.
So she didn't like that.
Yes, and then my producer, the youth of Australia have no right to be here on the Queen's tour. And they were like, okay, it's fine. But they put a security guard beside me. So every shot, there is a security guard behind my shoulder.
Really?
I don't know what they thought I was going to do. But
they were ready to grab you
just
in case you approached her.
Yes. And then, so a lot of those things where I was sort of really taking the piss out of authority, or, you know, I would walk into Channel 7 and get through security and be like on their TV show and
just walk in.
Yeah, with a TV camera. Seriously, I did it. I was on two stations at the same time.
How did you manage that?
I have this thing where if you just pretend you belong somewhere, people believe you.
Wow. I
got into the Cannes Film Festival, did the whole red carpet walk, everything, just pretending. And they were like so security conscious. Here I am on the red carpet. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's a funny thing. So, yeah, I used to do these things. And it was just nice to expose how serious people were about stuff. And
they are still
and
today.
And I just wasn't, you know.
But they still are today.
Yes.
They're still serious about
Everything's so serious.
Everything is so serious. And, you know, politicians just drive
I followed I followed Bob Hawke on his campaign trail. It was like The Chaser, 10 years before The Chaser. So I was on the campaign bus with, you know, all the journos, all the well-known journos, and just following Bob all the way around on his tour, and it was awesome. And the only one he ended up speaking to was me.
There you go. You've got to make your presence felt, don't you?
You do.
You have to. And I think it's something that as women we don't do these days. We don't put ourselves out there because we have this fear of judgment. Mm-hmm. What will people think of me? Mm-hmm. I'm not good enough. I don't know enough. I'm not intelligent enough. And this is what I find a lot of women think and feel about themselves.
Yeah. That mostly happened to me after a while, and the press had started to turn on me, and that's when I lost my nerve. That's when I lost my confidence. And I, with these tween books that I've written, that's one of the really major things I want girls to get out of it. Be that trouble. I mean that in the most positive way.
Absolutely.
Be that trouble that says, no, I don't think that's fair. No, you do need to listen to my opinion.
Have a voice.
Yes.
Give them a voice. And that's what it's all about, isn't it? It's like I look at kids that go to school. Sit. Mm. Behave. Stop talking. Do this. Think like
this. But it's even deeper than that. You know, like I was a really outspoken kid at school, and I was told my opinion were unwanted. It starts there in the classroom.
Absolutely. Well, that's what I'm saying. It starts in the classroom, and these kids get their creativity, their imagination, their fantasy, everything gets squashed, And they grow up into teenagers, they start doubting themselves, they don't have the confidence.
I think it's more of a, particularly in the entertainment industry, as we've seen lately, we've just seen how squashed some women have been.
Yes.
In this whole Hollywood scandal. But, you know, like I did lose my nerve because I got tired. I got tired of having to justify. And I just hope there's women in this generation who don't get exhausted by it, who don't need to get exhausted by it because it's going to be easier for them.
Right. Okay, now let's talk about your books. The first book that you wrote, and I have to reread it,
Tracy Lacey
is completely cuckoo bananas.
Correct.
Talk to me about that. Are you telling a story about your experiences in that book?
Both of the books
both
are largely based on some of the experiences that I had at school.
Right.
Some of the more embarrassing or humiliating times. But the thing was, I survived them.
Oh, absolutely.
And at the time, they were huge and momentous. But now I look back and I go, yeah, this is great. This is a great way to sort of show people that you can just go that far and still survive. So a lot of the embarrassing things that happened to me in school, or experiences like, you know, like it was always the one that people go, yeah, Tanya, you should tell the teachers how we feel about this. And I'd be like, yeah, sure. And the teacher would come in and I'd be like, you know, and we feel this and we feel this, right, guys? And there'd just be no one. Crickets chirping.
Yeah.
That sudden, you know.
That okay. Become cowards.
Yeah, no one's there. Yeah. So I think that, I want people to see that you can be that person.
Yes.
It can work out.
Yes. And it's all about having that confidence in yourself, isn't it? It's not doubting who you are and having that confidence to have a voice.
Yeah.
And I find that a lot of women don't use their voice in that they need to use it now as adults.
Well, I didn't, you know, like certainly when the cameras were running, I had leeway to do that. But when the cameras were off and, you know, I had to have discussions with ABC management or whatever, I could not speak my mind. I was too afraid.
Really?
Yeah.
What was the fear? What was the fear behind?
Fear was that they would just get rid of me.
Right.
Yeah.
And how bad would that have been for you?
Well, you know, I was in a great position. I was young. I mean, maybe someone else would have picked me up, but of course I wanted to hold on to my job. I loved it. But I just don't think that, and even in my now in my life, I've only just started to be able to say, hang on a sec.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
We've got to talk about this, because when it gets down to the nitty-gritty or something like that, I
shut down.
Yeah,
shut down. And that's when, you know, and that's why I say my show is about conversation, and it's all about the good, the bad, and the ugly of life. And it's communicating, because that is the essence of anything, everything in our life. We need to communicate with what's going on. If there's something that's not going on, that's not right, or not, you're not happy, or whatever, you need to have that voice and communicate how you feel so that people understand and know where you're coming from.
Yeah, I think so. And I mean, no offense to men, I do believe that men are born and raised with a sense of entitlement that they're not even aware that they have.
Well, they are.
And that's not saying, you know, men, you're shits. It's just the way that it is.
Yes.
Okay? And
yes,
you guys, you've got that. It'd be really nice if they could identify and see that. So
yes.
Women don't have that.
No, they don't. And
It's insidious, because it's in so many things, the way things are worded, or, you know, like even marriage vows. And
I think you need
the way that if there's three women on a panel in television, they'll say an all woman panel, you know, they'll never go an all male panel.
No, no. I think women are stepping out more and using their voice more, but it still needs to be a lot more than what it is.
Yeah, I was really frightened too that I would be put down.
Yes.
That feared me more than anything. Like, to be put down for expressing my opinion, you know. And I have been, you know. If I wanted your opinion, I would have asked you what colour nail polish you were wearing.
Yes.
You know.
Now, Tanya, we have to go shortly because it's time for the news and the Samoans are going to take over, but don't go anywhere. And we have been live on Facebook.